I'm super stoked to have Nicolás Alcalá here. You're the founder of a company called Future Lighthouse. You were also one of our graduate students in the Singularity Global Solutions Program in 2015, as Abby was.
Yeah.
And tell us a bit about Future Lighthouse. It's in VR. So I give you away, this talk will be all geeking out on VR, AR, future of storytelling. Super excited. Tell us about Future Lighthouse. What are you doing?
Future Lighthouse. We founded it 2 years ago, right before going to Singularity. And it's basically, so it started as a content studio. We wanted to tell stories in VR because it's the best medium ever invented to tell stories. And because it's a new industry and everything was new, and you know, I was coming from film and I was like all about trying to break up things and rethinking how movies are made and how they're distributed. With VR, it was like, hey, we don't need to break anything. We just need to invent it from scratch and think about how we want it to be. So it started as such, but then at the same time, I've always been very connected with technology, and I love where technology and storytelling merge. And I believe we tell the stories that we tell thanks to technology. I mean, writing, photography, all of those are technologies that have reshaped how we tell stories. So in the end, we are also creating technologies to think about what's next for storytelling.
We talked about this, I talked with a guest about this earlier, like this idea of every new medium in the beginning seems to emulate the old medium, right? How do you break out, and I know that you guys are not emulating the old medium, and you just hinted at this. How do you avoid this? Like, how do you, like...
I think with VR we have a rare gift because it's so different from the previous ones that from scratch, it's like you're encouraged to do so. So if you try what you usually do, it doesn't work. And it's so much fun to bring, like, I am a film director, but I've always think differently. It's so much fun when we bring like filmmakers and writers and people from the traditional video game or film industry. So they're like, what do you mean I cannot frame? What do you mean there is no focus? It's like, no. Yeah, and it doesn't work. I mean, when you try to do it traditionally, it doesn't work. So it forces you to be innovative all the time and to prototype all the, that's another fun thing. I came into this with a very like technology innovation background. So for me, prototyping is the norm. Right. But in film, this is like an unknown thing.
Well, it's also really expensive typically, right? I mean, not these days, but like recently.
So what we've started to do, which usually in film you don't do, is like doing previews, like previsualizations of the things that we're gonna do, or we fake it with like bad cameras, like cheap cameras, and just, you know, ourselves. But you need to test it out.
Right. So how do you think VR movies will look like? Is there such a thing as a VR movie even?
I don't think we're gonna call them movies.
Okay.
I think there's gonna be experiences that are gonna be more or less interactive. So it's gonna be, you know, movies and video games and everything in between. But we're not gonna call them movies anymore. There are so many fascinating things that are going to happen. First of all, I think they're going to be way more interactive than they are right now. Immersive, of course, you're going to feel like you're inside of the film, but you're going to start to have characters that react to you, characters that are AI-driven, right. And when you actually do something, they react to your emotions.
Well, in a lot of ways, we have this in computer games today, right?
Yes.
I mean, in a somewhat primitive way,
exactly.
But...
In the future, so what I see is that we're not going to be filming the real world anymore. Like in about 8 to 10 years, everything's going to be CGI generated. You're not going to be able to tell the difference between that and like virtual and real. So everything we're going to do with the computer, so we can do it, so it can be modified in real time. And you are going to be able to change the background and change the sky, and the characters are going to react to you. And one thing that we're working on, and which I believe is going to be the absolute future of entertainment, is what we call reactive content. So it's content that is not only interactive because you have an input and you do something, but also because it knows who you are. So you'll add inputs like your age, your sex, your location, what colors you love, what kind of music. We're going to analyze your Spotify and say, you know what, for this piece in which we want like relaxing music, let's analyze what music you listen to after 8 p.m., which is when you finish work, and then put something that is similar to that as a background music.
I tell you, when you look at my Spotify list, like all the movies I will watch will be like really, really weird and trippy. So I'm a little shocked about this. Do you think we will still have movies? Like movies as in the two-dimensional version and the collective experience of us going into a movie theater, right? Like the Star Wars premiere, right? Where we all like queue and like
So movies per se, eventually I think will disappear. The same way, I mean, there will be some, the same way we still have some black and white films or silent films.
Okay.
But it's gonna be a rare thing. It's not gonna be the norm. The collective experience, for sure, it's gonna have a different shape. It's gonna have a shape in which you're gonna have mixed reality experiences, like The Void is doing, where you're gonna go to a place and you're gonna be physically with your friends, but in a virtual reality where you're all interacting. Or you're gonna have the social experience virtually. So you're still gonna connect with somebody on the other side of the world and experience in film, and you're gonna watch it from one of the characters' perspective, and I'm gonna watch it from the other one, and we're gonna share the experience way more than we do in a movie theater. But in a movie theater, I'm looking at the film, and I'm not looking at you, I'm not talking to you, we talk about it afterwards. But if we are both inside the film, and each one of us is a character, and we can influence what the other one is seeing or experiencing, that's social, for real.
Interesting. And do you think the medium will be... So VR today is the tethered head, typically tethered headset. It's pretty clunky, like it's not super comfortable to wear for like really long periods of times. It's kind of antisocial. Like, what do you think the hardware side of it, where does that evolve? Because it needs to evolve, right? I really can't see us like wearing these things.
100%.
Like,
this is a matter of how much time it's going to take. What I see is, first of all, what I see is that there's not going to be a difference between AR and VR. You know, we continue doing, you know, saying like VR is dead because AR is on. It's the same thing. It's just how many layers you have in front of reality. So it's going to be the same device. You're going to go from AR to VR like that. Depends on the app that you're working on. So now we're going to have a conversation. Let's go to Bali and have that in VR. But now we're having an interview, so let's have a mixed reality in which, you know, I'm a hologram, but we're seeing the background. So same device, that's for sure. Same kind of content, same platforms. Eventually, that will evolve to contact lenses, something like very light. And eventually, what I think it makes more sense. So we try to emulate how we feel. We're using a lot of haptic technologies to, you know, to feel. But like the whole body, that's a pretty big organ. It's very difficult to mimic how you feel by touching, smelling, hearing. What I feel is that it's way easier once we solve how the brain works. It's gonna be way easier to tap into our optical nerve and say to the brain, "This is what you need to see." And that's what I envision the future of VR to be. That's, I don't know, 25, 30 years, but it's going to happen.
So David Roberts, who's faculty here at Singularity University, I think he spoke yesterday here at the conference. In one of his talks, he also talks about like this idea that the virtual reality, the virtual worlds will be better than our own reality. And, you know, higher resolution, you know, we will have capabilities which we don't have in our physical embodiment. And thus we might choose to live our lives in those virtual realities. Is that a positive? I mean, like, it kind of like, it brings up this like, oh wow, this is like the Matrix, you know, particularly if you like think about like neofrontal cortex, like brain computer interfaces, etc.
That's definitely gonna happen at some point, at least as a possibility. Not sure if we're all gonna get there. There's a lot of philosophical implications, and it's fun because I got deeper and deeper in the philosophy behind VR, and every time, so since starting at SU, and every time it's like I'm here and we're discussing about going to explore all the planets and going like expanding, and it's like, and when I think about it, it's like it's much more likely with the exponential curve of technology that in 40 or 50 years we're able to download our conscience into a virtual reality made for ourselves that has infinite possibilities in which we are gods because we can control every outcome of it, and that we just live in multiple universes, then that we go and expand and create like Dyson spheres to control energy. So why would you do that? Which is one of my favorite Fermi paradox explanations. It's like, if you can create a virtual reality that simulates this and is 10 times better and you don't need your body anymore, why would we, you know, this is what we agree to call reality, but it might as well be a simulation that we still don't know the code for.
For sure. That gets us into a deep rabbit hole, which we can like spend the next like, you know, years on. I'm curious. So this is a conversation about VR. It's important. I think it's important to understand, like, it's not a conversation about just storytelling and media. And you actually made an interesting bold statement where you said that you predict that VR will affect half the world's industry within a decade. Can you elaborate a little bit on this? Like, what does this mean?
Well, first of all, there is a lot of industries that are directly affected by it, like medicine or education or transportation, but teaching people how to use things, entertainment for sure. So all of those are gonna get disrupted by VR because it makes more sense to experience those things in VR. It's cheaper to produce, you can massively put it out there, you can learn way more, and it enhances our human experience. At the same time, I think VR has the capability to start changing our minds, to start changing who we are as human beings. And this is, again, getting deep into philosophical realm, but in the end, it's like, if I'm able to transport you to 2,000 years ago and trick your brain into thinking you're actually there, and you spend there like 5 hours or 12 hours or 5 days, for your brain, you've actually been there. So you've traveled back in time. I can also do that forward.
Right.
I can connect you with beings that you loved that are not there anymore. So reality becomes something that, you know, is not so certain. And that will definitely affect how we see the world, how we connect with each other. It's the same thing that happens with psychedelics. Like, it's like a different reality that shows you things that you wouldn't even think they existed, and it will give you a different perspective on life, on who you are, on where we is. This, I always use this example. Like, since the invention of the microscope, we didn't know that in every cell of our skin there was a million other beings. Same with the telescope. We thought we were the center of the universe until we got technology to see there was something else. So I feel VR is gonna make us reassess who we are, and that will obviously impact social, political, every kind of thing.
Those are really deep questions, my friend. This is amazing. I'm curious, you're doing stuff today, and you won a bunch of prizes for films you actually have produced, which you have made, and you're going to Venice, correct? To the Venice Film Festival.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about this. Tell also our audience, like, where do they find your work? Because I'm pretty sure, like, everybody's like, you know, sitting there with their Google Cardboard now, and it's like, oh my God, I want to experience this.
So the things that we're working on, so as I said, we decided to start on the content side as a studio to figure out like the storytelling side of it. Now we're diving into the technology. So we've been working with big Hollywood studios to produce their VR films, traditional original content as well. We are mostly, you can see our work at film festivals, like the Italy Venice Film Festival or like any other of the big ones. But it's also on any VR platform. You can go to the Oculus Store or to Steam or to Daydream, and you're gonna find our content there.
So they have to look for what to find it?
Future Lighthouse in any of the VR distribution sites.
So Lighthouse on all the content platforms?
Yeah.
And tell us a little bit about like you have made two quote-unquote feature films, right? Two like feature films, quote-unquote, in VR, right? Like you've got two pieces which have won significant prizes.
Yeah, so we have premiered one already called Tomorrow, which is actually, I wrote that one while I was at GSP, and it's a pretty cool one because it talks about VR as a new language, not a new technology, but a new language, something that will teach us new words to understand new realities. That one can even be watched on YouTube. It's a 5-minute small piece, but it's very touching into the subjects of like singularity.
So that's Tomorrow, right?
That's called Tomorrow. The other two original productions that we have produced are Melita and Ray, and those will both premiere next month at Venice Film Festival and Rainland Film Festival.
That's awesome. All right, let me ask you one last personal question. And it's a yes or no answer.
Okay.
So with everything we have talked about, is this here already a simulation, or is this real as in real?
The answer, I would say, the short is yes. The slightly longer is we have way many more chances of being a simulation than not. I want to believe.